This is the Queen Elizabeth. That's the QE1 for those of you that are keeping count. For 50 years in the first part of the 20th century, she and her sister ocean liners dominated the market for transatlantic business transportation. If you wanted to travel between the United States and Europe, you rode on an ocean liner. Oh, by the end of World War II, it had become possible to fly commercially across the ocean, but why would anybody want to endure 18 to 30 hours of cramped, noisy, cold, smelly, vibrating discomfort with half a dozen stops along the way when by traveling on a ship, you could ride in comfort, indeed in luxury, and arrive at your destination in less than a week? No, as recently as the mid-1950s, the leaders of all of the ocean carriers would have told you that business executives would never give up the convenience and comfort and luxury of traveling across the ocean by ship. And so it was. Until August of 1957, when Pan American Airlines introduced Boeing 707 nonstop jet service from New York to London in 8 hours. And in 6 months, Atlantic Ocean passenger transportation business lost 90% of its revenue. Disruptive technologies can have sudden and profound impacts on business. Here's another example of just such a technology. You enjoyed Rimsky-Korsakov's Flight of the Bumblebee there, but what you saw was an entire working electric car printed in 44 hours, printed and fully assembled, working within 44 hours, and only 40 parts required for it. The benefits of additive manufacturing, more commonly known as 3D printing, are profound. Fewer wasted materials. The possibility of longer lifespans for products as it becomes much less expensive and easier to replace parts. Less transportation of finished products because you can print key parts and even finished products much closer to the point of use or consumption. Because of that, you can reduce inventories, you have fewer unsold products. It's a way that can reach disconnected markets worldwide and will have a profound impact on improving standards of living around the globe. And it's no surprise then that the global market for 3D printing is exploding. It's projected that between 2013 and 2018, we're going to see a compound annual growth rate of over 45% between the market for 3D printers and for the services and materials used in 3D printing. Already, 60% of companies are either actively using 3D printing or evaluating it for use either within the next 12 months or at some point down the road. Now, the 40% of the companies that have no plans to evaluate or implement it, well, unfortunately for them, they're probably not here today, and that is only to their detriment. because this is a technology that's going to profoundly impact us moving forward. For manufacturers, the benefits are very significant. In traditional subtractive manufacturing, milling, machining, where we start with a piece of material and then remove what we don't need. Michelangelo said centuries ago, looking at a giant block of marble, "I know the statue of David is in there, I just need to remove the additional parts that aren't what I vision." We've been using subtractive manufacturing since the first cave people chipped axe heads out of flint. Additive manufacturing, though, takes the material you need and in the appropriate very small increments builds it up to what you need. So there is no wasted material in it. The printers can work unattended, so you can have lights out factories working on an ongoing basis 24/7. They can print interlocking parts. You've got an example of one of these on your table with the small bearing, plastic bearing there. A high level of complexity can be created in a single run. You can create objects with geometries that classical subtractive manufacturing techniques simply can't create on their own. They require a lot of human intervention into the assembly process. And by moving the creation of parts, materials, products closer to their consumption point, it shortens supply chains because you can distribute the goods directly to the printer rather than have to create them in one place and then physically ship those finished products somewhere else. One of the areas where additive manufacturing is having a profound impact is in what's called augmented manufacturing, where companies are saying, we may or may not in our particular business have the technology and the economic justification right now today to create all of our finished product parts via additive manufacturing, but we can still gain experience in working with the technology and have a strong economic justification for using it by using it to create specialized tools, jigs, and fixtures, and so forth that we use in our manufacturing processes and have them created in a matter of hours rather than weeks to have these things specially tooled. This speeds up the production cycle, the design cycles, and it accelerates the time to market for new products. It also facilitates mass customization, because as customers have specified requirements and those in turn may have special tooling that's required, you can create that tooling much less expensively and much more quickly than you could with traditional subtractive manufacturing. But don't misunderstand me. We're already beginning to see additive manufacturing used substantially for production parts. In fact, as long ago as 2012, already some 28% of additive manufacturing was used for production parts. The numbers are going up significantly. It's going to displace a significant proportion of traditional computer numerically controlled machining, and that in turn is going to reshape the manufacturing landscape, particularly when you're talking about short-run, high-quality end-use parts. For certain types of parts, if you need to create tens of thousands or millions of them, it may be another year or two or three, or in some cases five, before the economic justification is fully there. But right now, already for many parts, if you need to create only a few thousand and certainly a few hundred or less than that, it can very often be done far more cost effectively with 3D printing, additive manufacturing, than with traditional manufacturing methods. And the big engineering giants already realize this. Companies like Airbus, Boeing, GE, Ford, Siemens, they're already hybridizing their manufacturing activities where they're integrating the use of additive manufacturing with traditional manufacturing techniques to optimize their costs, their supply chains, and their manufacturing processes. Here's an excellent example of this. GE has printed jet fuel nozzles for their new LEAP engines that are going to start going into airplanes starting next year. Now, they have to have 19 of these nozzles in each engine, and they have to be flawlessly created. And by using titanium powder to print these metal parts, they're able to create parts that are five times as durable as the traditionally manufactured ones, 25% lighter, which of course is critical when you're building airplanes. Every pound you take off of the weight of an airplane saves a large airline $11,000 a year in fuel costs. It runs cooler, so they'll last longer, and it's machined as a single part instead of previously 18 separate parts that then had to be welded together. It's going to have a huge impact on many industries. The auto industry is just one. To give you an example, even where per unit costs may be a little bit higher for a while, they're going to be more than offset by drastic reductions in shipping costs and the carrying costs of extra inventories, because you can create the parts at the point of consumption. Cars today are just made in a few hundred factories around the world, but it's possible within another 5 to 10 years that we'll see automobiles assembled in every major metropolitan area. The main parts can be, raw materials can be brought in, the main parts can be printed locally, and then final assembly take place, much smaller factories, and be able to deliver and to update models much more quickly. And small parts, replacement parts, can be made right at dealerships and repair shops rather than having to wait for them to be shipped in. This also significantly reduces the need for supply chain management. We will still have supply chains to manage, but they'll be simpler, shorter, less value tied up in those supply chains. It'll still be critical to manage them well, but there'll be less cost. That will reduce at less cost for the end product and improve standard of living around the globe. Now, that's just one example. We could go through a similar analysis if we had time in each of these other areas. And these are just some of the ones where there's already widespread agreement that these industries are going to be profoundly affected. In fact, virtually every industry that deals with tangible products is going to be impacted by additive manufacturing. Supply chains, well, what we're seeing in general is for the last century, we've moved from a highly centralized manufacturing process toward more decentralized processes. If you've ever seen a picture of the River Rouge Ford plant outside of Detroit prior to World War II, Henry Ford used to brag that raw materials came in one end of the plant and finished automobiles rolled out of the other end of the plant. They made the steel in the plant. They made the rubber in the plant. And then they did all of the creation of the parts, the assembly, and put it all together. Highly centralized manufacturing operation. Well, over the last century, these have become much more decentralized. Scale has been reduced. Outsourcing has taken place to people with expertise and specialties in creating various different kinds of parts, components, sub-assemblies, and so forth. As a result of automation and robotics and telecommunications, we have a much more efficient manufacturing supply chain. But there's still a lot of cost because of the need for movement of all of these physical parts, assemblies, and components around. Now, with more goods being manufactured at or very close to the point of purchase or consumption, you don't need to have the scale efficiencies of large centralized plants in order to have cost efficiencies. So what this means is that businesses all along the supply, manufacturing, and retailing supply chains will have to rethink their strategies and operations. This is going to have as profound an impact on how we do business for any of us who are involved with physical, tangible products as the internet and the World Wide Web has had on us over the last 10 to 15 years. What this can do is change the nature of goods, because for the most part, what it means is we're going to be moving raw materials around in decreasingly sized quantities. But raw materials take up a lot less space than the finished goods that are made out of those materials do, because the finished goods can be created via printing. And the big delivery companies are already well aware of this. They're not waiting around to be cannibalized. UPS and FedEx and others, they're already putting 3D printers in many of the UPS offices, for example, so that people who want to be able to have a 3D printed object available nearby and then delivered to their home or come and pick it up can have that readily available. They realize that this is going to change their nature of their business. They don't want to be like the U.S. Postal Service, which got caught flat-footed when email and the internet came in the 90s and the 2000s, suddenly realized all their first-class mail was going away. And it's going to have an impact on logistics on a global basis. Again, as we shift transportation from finished goods to raw materials, as we start manufacturing custom-built orders on site rather than selling products off the shelf. Now, that's not to say there aren't going to be products on the shelf. But when you can reproduce in the few hours in the back room the products to replenish the supply, rather than waiting for days or weeks for it to be shipped from a supplier, you can maintain the minimal inventory of those items actually on the shelf just for the people, if you're a retailer, who are going to walk in and buy it off the shelf during that day or during that shift. So you don't have to tie up as much in inventory. You don't need to have as much floor space. All of these are going to impact the ways we do business. And in global trade, by disintermediating parts of the supply chain, there's going to be less need to import products. This is going to have a huge impact on the balance of trade between the U.S. and China. Because when you can create manufactured objects here in the U.S. as inexpensively as those same manufactured objects could be created by traditional manufacturing techniques in China, the competitive advantages of China's lower labor costs go away. And the value that's in the underlying design and the cost of the raw materials is all that's needed. So it's going to put much more emphasis on the value of products that are and the design of those products than it is on the traditional manufacturing and assembly of those products. Now, that also means that there's going to be fewer products moving back and forth across the oceans. Fewer shipments are going to be necessary. We'll still have some. We'll still have to move some raw materials around. Certain raw materials exist only in given places in the world, and yet will still be needed in various other places to create products that are composed in part of those materials. Titanium is only mined in a few places. So we're going to have to move titanium around, the ores or the finished ingots that eventually will be powdered into use, for example, in creating titanium metal jet parts like the fuel nozzle we saw a few minutes ago. But there's going to be a need for less shipping. There'll be fewer products moving through ports. What are the implications of that politically, economically? We're going to be seeing a big shift in terms of, just as we have with the internet, in terms of where economic value lies. There's going to be disintermediation of certain companies. There's going to be changes in certain roles. Manufacturing employees are going to have to understand better the underlying digital technologies that drive additive manufacturing, and yet not necessarily have to have all of the same additive manufacturing skills that they've traditionally had to have in manufacturing. Now, when it comes to end consumers' products, traditionally what we've seen is we go from raw material to manufacturers, to wholesalers, to retail shops, and to the end consumers. But now we have the possibility of, in fact, disintermediating all of those other steps and going from raw materials to 3D printers to the consumers. That could be because you have a 3D service bureau nearby you. So Amazon, it's breaking its back to try to figure out ways to deliver tangible products on the same day. And yet in another very few years, that may be commonplace because it can either be delivered to you or you can go and pick it up at a 3D printer bureau someplace very close by to you, you know, within a couple of miles or even a few blocks. Or you may have that printer at home and print it yourself. Now, in the course of preparing this presentation and looking at what other experts on 3D printing and additive manufacturing have had to say on the subject, I must have seen half a dozen times a statement to the effect of, well, 3D printing is going to have a huge impact on us, especially additive manufacturing in the industrial sector, but no individual is ever going to need to have a 3D printer in their home. I read that phrase three or four different industry analysts and pundits said almost exactly that. And I kept thinking to myself, where have I heard that before? Where have I heard that before? Ah, 1977, when the CEO of Digital Equipment, Ken Olson, famously said, there is no reason for any individual to have a computer in his home. And we all know how that turned out. Within 15 years, Digital Equipment was owned by a PC manufacturing company, Compaq. Well, you might ask, what about intellectual property? If we're going to be able to print these items, and especially if we can have individuals in their own homes, what's to keep them from printing up duplicate copies of all of these items and taking them out and selling them on the general market and disintermediating the designer, the creator of those items, from their share of the profits and the value that they deserve, that they would have gotten if traditional additive manufacturing was the only way for those items to be created? Well, in fact, there's a couple of different factors that come into play that are going to help to resolve this problem. Now, the pieces aren't all here yet today, but they're coming together. And it's very analogous to a situation I saw about 15 years ago. I was speaking to a group like this, talking about the emergence of e-commerce and the World Wide Web as a force in the economy and in society. And I remember somebody in the room standing up and objecting. And this was a fellow who was very technically knowledgeable. And he said, I'm sorry, but apparently you don't understand something, Mr. Shaw. You don't understand that we do not have the necessary bandwidth in our telecommunications, and we do not have the necessary security controls in place, and that is why you will never see internet banking taking place. Anybody here use internet banking? Can I see your hands if you do any banking online? Uh-huh. Just about all of us do. Okay? So when I hear people say, well, here's this limitation of 3D printing or this constraint on additive manufacturing, I take it with a great number of grains of salt, because unless there's something out there that requires a violation of fundamental laws of physics, if the economic justification is going to be there, the technical experts will figure out a way to address the issue. And it's already happening. A couple of different pieces of this. At University of Virginia Research Center, they've already put quantum dots into 3D printed objects. Now, quantum dots are those microscopic, those are nanometers, 5.2 nanometers, sub-microscopic objects that in large volume are used to create LED lights. But by putting certain small quantities of these quantum dots into 3D printed objects, those objects can be scanned with infrared scanners and other kinds of readers that can create a unique signature, very similar to the fact that, as many of you now are aware, diamonds are all unique, and there's ways of scanning them to look at the refraction and reflection of light waves, and even if it looks to the eye like it's two identical diamonds, you can tell the difference in which is which. So we can uniquely identify individual objects created via additive manufacturing. Now, how do we know whether somebody is authorized, though, and has actually paid for the right to create multiple objects? The answer to that lies in an unexpected location. One of the interesting questions right now is, are we going to see the replacement of traditional banks by digital currencies such as Bitcoin? Well, that's a whole other topic that we can get off to later. But let's talk about how Bitcoin really works. We're not going to talk about the value of Bitcoin, whether it's going to replace current currencies. And by the way, no, it's not, but it's going to be a viable alternative payment mechanism, in my opinion. But how does it work? The key underlying Bitcoin is what's called the blockchain. Every transaction anywhere in the world that takes place in Bitcoin is recorded by adding a record to the blockchain. But here's the thing that's key. You can't play around with the blockchain or the records that are in the blockchain, because each record added to it has a hash of all the previous records embedded in it. If you tried to change anything, the entire your copy, your version of the blockchain, would end up being inconsistent with everyone else. So it's a way, it's a logical digital way of having fully verifiable, non-deniable exchange of digital value and a record of those digital transactions. Accurate, verifiable, non-deniable. That's why you have a unique value of currency that can be exchanged and a record of that currency, and it's secure. It doesn't have to be printed on a specially printed fancy piece of paper in order to be secure. In fact, ultimately, it's much more secure than printed currency is. But if that can be used for the exchange of pure currency value, why can't it be used for other things? Why just money? Why not stocks or bonds, which themselves are digital records of ownership or debt? Why not car titles or house deeds? And in fact, we're going to see all of these things. There are efforts underway to do all of these different things. And indeed, why not 3D printing blueprints? The same mechanism can be used to convey digitally the rights to create a specified number and only a specified number of a given 3D printed item in exchange for value paid for that right to create those items. And if those items have quantum dots embedded in them, you can go back and verify that they're each uniquely separately identifiable and that only the number fully authorized has been created. Now, are all the pieces in place to make that as easy today as paying online is? No, but I can remember a time, and we all can remember a time, when the notion of actually entering your credit card into a computer to buy something online, you'd have to be crazy to do that. And we all do it every day now. The same thing's going to be taking place and much more quickly. So, fasten your seatbelts, because as we look on down the road, things are going to get even more exciting. Predicting the future is always a challenge. And I, for one, rely in part on the words of a great American, Yogi Berra, who once said, "Making predictions is very hard, especially about the future." And that's true. But there's a few things I think we can safely predict. One of the things that's very exciting is the Internet of Things. What is the Internet of Things? Well, up until about 25 years ago, basically, digital communications went to about a billion places in the world where hard telephone lines had been laid. But as we took off with email capabilities and the emergence of the internet, we got the ability to communicate to people via email and subsequently the web, and the ability to communicate with some 5 billion out of our 7 billion residents of the planet that have regular access to the internet. Now we're starting to see things with intelligence built into them, the ability to communicate in physical objects. Gartner projects that by 2020, 26 billion physical objects will have communications capabilities that connect them to the internet. Cisco says it'll be 50 billion. IDC says it may be over 200 billion by that time, including 30 billion connected autonomous things. What are autonomous things? Well, let me come back to that in a minute. But the point is that these things will be able to communicate. But to understand that, we have to look back. One of the keys to predicting the future is understanding the past and where we've come from. And the interesting thing is with 3D printing, we see a convergence of two different streams of evolution. When it comes to information technology over the last half century, we've gone from mainframe computing, we've superseded, not replaced it, but added, augmented it with PC computing. In the 90s, client-server computing, tying together computers within the four walls of the enterprise. The internet and the World Wide Web starting in the late 90s and coming on up through the current day. Now, all of these technologies continue to evolve. But each one has an exponentially greater impact on business and society than its predecessor. And we're seeing the same thing taking place in manufacturing technologies. 2 centuries ago, we had the invention of replaceable parts, Eli Whitney and the cotton gin. 1 century ago, we had the assembly line with Henry Ford. Now with additive manufacturing, we've got another great leap forward in terms of our physical manufacturing and creation capabilities. And the two merge in what's referred to as digital manufacturing. Now, when it comes to information technology, there is, in fact, another wave of technology that we are at the very early stages of, and that's intelligent systems. And if you've used Siri, or if you watched Watson trounce the world champions in Jeopardy, you've seen examples of intelligent systems. But those are just scratching the surface compared to what we're going to see. Here's an example of one right now. This is the Boeing X-45 unmanned combat air vehicle. It is an autonomous jet fighter and attack aircraft. Unlike the drones, which are remotely controlled, although this certainly can be remotely controlled by a pilot who monitors it, it's able to function fully autonomously. It understands its mission objectives, can create a route, avoid enemy fire, execute its mission, and return to base without any human intervention required whatsoever. When two or more of these travel together, they exchange information about their current capabilities and their objectives and negotiate among themselves as to which aircraft is going to undertake which activities in order to maximize the likelihood of success of the mission as a whole. So they may be flying together and one of them says, there's the bridge I need to take out. Yes, but here comes some enemy aircraft. All right, you hold off the enemy aircraft, I'll go bomb the bridge. All done digitally, in real time, autonomously, without any human intervention required in the process. Now, here's the kicker. This video we are looking at is 10 years old. This was the state of the art of artificial intelligence a decade ago, and it's continued to evolve ever since that time, and is now just beginning to be widely applied in business. What we are seeing is that as information technology infrastructures create huge quantities of data, that data can be mined. Tools like natural language processing can be used to interpret unstructured data. That provides input. And tools like associative memory for pattern recognition and machine learning can actually help automated, autonomous systems make decisions in ways very similar to how human experts in a given field make a decision. That information can be fed back into the process to continually enhance the learning and improve the decision-making process. If you're familiar with zip cars, I want to go rent a car just for a few hours or even a few minutes. Go get a zip car. But you're also undoubtedly familiar with Google's driverless car that's been in development for a while. Gone hundreds of thousands of miles, the only accident so far took place when the driverless car was sitting properly stopped at a red light and was hit behind by a human-operated car that didn't stop on time. Well, what happens when you combine the two? The driverless zip car. You don't have to go get the car. You call it and it comes to you. It's Uber without the driver. That cuts your costs. That is an example of an autonomous thing, if you will. But it doesn't have to be something as large as a car that builds separate standalone, has separate standalone computer and communications capabilities added to it. Those electronic capabilities can be built right into the physical object And in fact, we've already got, using a material called carbomorph that can conduct electricity, the ability to build electronic circuitry, electronic devices, directly into 3D printed objects. So they can be printed with the circuitry, with the smarts already built in. Now they'll have to use the built-in wireless communications capabilities to download the appropriate software and the intelligent decision-making functionality, but that process itself can be automated. So whether it's a simple computer, or a glove, a mug that knows whether it needs more, or an object that needs to know how much of it is needed. Maybe it's a part on a jet engine that knows how long it's going to be before it's going to need to be serviced. And if it's got 8 more hours of operating life and it's going to land 6 hours from now at a given airport, it can send ahead the signal to say, print another copy of me so that as soon as we land, you can swap out the part without any lost time. This is all going to be part of global autonomous processes and enterprises and supply chains and supply networks, where up and down the organization, up and down what we now think of as the supply chain, communication takes place automatically, where materials are exchanged, finished parts where that's still necessary or required, services, information, designs, money, are all exchanged seamlessly between organizations that have intelligent, autonomous business management systems running in the background, dynamically managing business processes according to the goals and objectives and constraints defined by the management of that organization, and interacting with those of other entities and organizations according to agreed upon and contractually committed business arrangements, but doing so highly dynamically. I'm from Atlanta, Georgia, and last year my hometown newspaper had a very interesting article about sticker shock and pricing. Now, we've been used to the idea for decades now that the value of stocks and bonds and financial instruments fluctuates up and down, not only daily but hourly, by the minute, and nowadays by the millisecond. And in fact, most of us have had the experience with the fact that airline tickets typically do much the same thing. How many people have gone to look at their alternatives for buying a ticket, look at airline A, look at airline B, look at airline C, say, yep, airline A had the best deal, let's go back there. Oop, that deal's no longer available. 7 minutes have gone by, the price has changed already. Well, what we're going to be seeing in the future, as we have fluctuations of supply and demand, that will never go away, is that we will see fluctuating prices dynamically taking place. We'll have to get used to this idea, but we'll have also automated systems that can seek out the best prices for us. Here's an example of just such a system. Now, in this case, it is not a specific tangible product. It's mobile commerce advertising placement on the fly, a company called AdTherent. So if you're using a mobile app, when you click that button or touch that point on the screen to invoke some kind of additional information from that app, what it will do is send a signal to AdTherent saying, hey, there's an advertising opportunity here. If this person has opted in to have ads presented in this app, we can take first-party information available directly from that person that they've opted to share, plus general third-party information that may be available, anything from generalizations on demographics to what's the geographic location, that sort of thing. Combine that and use that to identify which brand is most likely to be of interest to this person using this app at this place, what the optimal creative advertising presentation to present is, calculate the likelihood of conversion into a purchase and the gross margin that would be generated, and determine an optimal bid price for presenting that ad. Is it a penny? Is it a nickel? Is it a dollar? And then present the ad to the person who then may or may not interact with it. If they interact with it and click on it, they may buy something or they may not. They may ignore it completely. Either way, however they act or fail to react, feeds back into the system. And the system learns more so that it can refine this process And it goes through this entire process completely in the time between when the person clicks that submit button on the app and the screen refreshes, an average of 50 milliseconds. And it does this, every time it does this, it gets smarter about what works well. And it does this a billion times a day. So we're talking about a system that gets smarter with every transaction a billion times a day. That's a pretty smart system. Now that's just for advertising. But what we're going to be seeing is an evolution over the next decade or so to self-configuring business ecosystems, where we have intelligent, autonomous technologies working under well-defined goals, objectives, and constraints established by management, continuously scanning the business ecosystems of the world, identifying opportunities to add value and take out cost in whatever product or service they're delivering. And 3D printed technologies, additive manufacturing is going to have a huge impact on this, because it means in many cases you're going to be able to disintermediate the traditional manufacturers and the traditional supply chains and go directly to digital delivery of a design to a manufacturing point that is close to the point of use or consumption of that item. But even then, they'll be continuously looking, because maybe another designer has a better design. Maybe another printing location is going to be better for distribution of that item to the end consumption point. But continuously reconfiguring this, you can almost think of something like an intelligent, autonomous version of a system that combines the best of Amazon.com, LinkedIn, Facebook, and Match.com. And you might say, well, yes, that's all nice that you might theoretically be able to find potential new partners out there in real time. And if you've both got intelligent systems that can interact with one another, those intelligent systems can negotiate among themselves, much as the Boeing X-45 aircraft negotiate among themselves, as to what deal is most mutually advantageous and meets the goals and objectives of both organizations. But, oh my gosh, then you have to go through that whole process of creating contracts and emailing them back and forth and printing them out and sign it. No. That's where the Bitcoin blockchain, the technology underlying that, gives you the ability to also, again, if it's within the authorization of these automated systems, engage in those contracts and negotiate them. With the speeding up of design capabilities that we're going to be having as a result of additive manufacturing technologies, with the speeding up of the ability to find new markets, new customers, new suppliers, new partners for best serving the needs of those end markets. We're going to take the time that historically, up until the last couple of years, has taken us months, if not years, to design new products, weeks, if not months, to manufacture those products, and days, if not weeks, to physically deliver them to the points of use or consumption, and shrink the entire process down to a matter of hours, where somebody will think of an idea of something that they would like first thing in the morning, and before the end of the day, they've got the physical, tangible product in their hand. That's pretty hard for most of us to imagine. But anybody in the room over 30 years old will admit that 25 or 30 years ago, the notion that all of us in real time would have little devices this size that were more powerful than all but the biggest computers on the planet at that time, that could communicate wirelessly, help us keep up with our calendars, help us communicate with our friends, family, and relatives. If anybody had suggested that such a thing would be possible within our lifetimes in those days, they would have been told they were crazy. Trust me, I was many times. So it's all about change and progress. To look back at, to look forward, you need to understand the past. And we can go back to the famed historian Henry Steele Commager from the early 20th century, who put it extremely well when he said, quite accurately, that change in and of itself does not necessarily assure progress. But progress implacably requires change. 3D printing, additive manufacturing is one of the biggest changes to hit our economy in history. It's going to have as profound, in some respects even more profound, impact on us than what we've seen with the internet and the World Wide Web over the last 10 to 15 years. You need to be ready for it. If you're in the first category of that pie chart we looked at the beginning of companies that are already working with it, congratulations, keep up the good work. If you're in the people who are studying it with an eye toward putting it in place in the next year or so, you are on the right path. If you're thinking it's going to be longer than that, let me encourage you to accelerate your thought process a little bit. And if you're in the fourth category, well, like I said, you're probably not here in the room with us this morning, but you have a very serious risk if you're not seriously evaluating the potential of additive manufacturing. There's a very serious risk that you are, within the next very few years, find yourself in a position where you are at an unrecoverable competitive disadvantage. That is not where you want to be.